Regular viewers know I've got a lot of rules. The result of more than 30 years in the money management business. First as a broker, then as a hedge fund manager, then as a journalist and a commentator. I've got rules for investing, rules for trading, rules for what to do in a rally or a sell-off, for picking winners, for avoiding losers. That can be a lot to take in. But as I mentioned before, the point of all these rules is to help you learn from my mistakes and develop your own judgment. I just explained why you need to have a clear understanding of your own objectives before you start buying stocks, something more focused than merely trying to make some money. So let's pretend you've already done some self-reflection and you know what you're trying to accomplish. Now you can start buying individual stocks, enough to fill out a diversified portfolio of 5 to 10 names, right? Hold up. Before you buy anything, I need you to do one more thing. First, you have to do the homework. Now, I've covered this before. I'm going to give you a quick version right now. If you're going to invest enough money in a company for it to matter to your portfolio, you need to know what the heck the company does. You need to know how it makes its money and how much money it makes. The internet has made this whole process much easier. Certainly when I first started the show, holy cow, this is now a delight. I mean, you can go online, read the SEC filings, which contain a wealth of information. You can listen to or read the transcripts of the conference calls, which I regard as the best way to get familiar with a business and the key metrics that will drive its stock. Feel free to read some journalism on top of that. Listen to some opinions, anything to familiarize yourself with both company itself and the way its stock trades. And of course, I've written, I don't know, half a dozen books just about this topic, okay, about how to do the homework. But the actual research is just part of doing the homework. After you've learned what you can and developed a thesis, a theory about why you think the stock is headed higher, there's one final step. You have to explain that theory to another living, breathing human being. It doesn't even have to be a professional. You can talk to your mom, your kids, a friend. The important thing here is that you put your thesis into words that maybe you can basically comprehend it yourself. Lay out why you want to buy this thing and why you think it's headed higher. If there are major holes in your theory or you're relying on wishful thinking, usually a reasonable adult or even a mature teenager will be able to catch that. Once you've done that, though, then you are ready to pull the trigger. For those of you who are tuning me out because you can't stand to hear another word about homework, I'm done. That's it. That's all I'll say about that process of preparing to buy a stock, because tonight I'm trying to focus on the bigger picture. So let's fast forward a little. Once you've done the homework, you can build a diversified portfolio of 5 to 10 individual stocks. Now, any more than 10, and you'll likely won't have time to keep up with them all. The idea here is that you should be able to do this in your spare time, not that you'll turn money management into a second or third job. Well, how can I have so many stocks for actionalertsplus.com, which you can follow along, obviously, if you subscribe? Because I got two research assistants. You're doing it yourself. So let's assume you own shares in a bunch of companies that you genuinely believe in. You now have a thesis for each one. There's no sector overlap, meaning you have 5 to 10 companies in distinct industries that don't tend to trade together. Diversification, like we play on the show. In short, you have what in theory is an ideal portfolio. What's the most important thing for you to keep in mind? Above and beyond everything else, you need to know that your perfect portfolio won't stay perfect for long. Those 5 to 10 stocks you thought were winners? Yeah, unless you're absurdly lucky, not all of them will stay winners. Some will be losers. Some will do nothing. And some of the companies that you liked best will inevitably disappoint you. What can I say? The game is full of heartbreak. Which brings me to my next meta rule. Always please, please try to stay flexible. You have to be flexible because business, by its very nature, is dynamic, not static. Things do change. Markets change. New competitors will enter in an industry and undercut existing players on price to take market share. Previously well-run companies will start executing poorly, and we've seen that time and again. Customers cancel orders. Unforeseen events happen that hurt business or simply makes some category of stocks seem less attractive to the big institutional money managers who dominate the market. When something like this occurs, when the story of a company that you own shares in changes, well, then you got to be willing to acknowledge that things are different. If your thesis is no longer intact, if the reason you gave for buying a stock is no longer valid, then you should sell. This is why you need to explain your picks to another person, so that you can recognize when your original idea has stopped being workable. That may sound straightforward, but for decades, so-called experts have peddled the idea that when you buy a stock, you need to be prepared to hold on to it until the death of the universe. How many times have you heard someone say, buy and hold, buy and hold? Well, I've got to tell you, that's nonsense. Don't get me wrong. I would love to buy a stock and hold it from here to eternity because the story pans out and the darn thing keeps going higher. But if the story doesn't pan out or after a long time there are big changes in the industry, well, you got to be willing to sell.
Sell, sell, sell.
At least sell some. That's why I always tell you it's buy and homework, not buy and hold. I just wish a lot of the graybeards would adopt buy and homework. We'd save people a lot of money. Now, I bring this up because people hate admitting when they've made a mistake. And, of course, they hate selling anything because they're worried about taxes. But once we make up our minds that things are great for, say, Coca-Cola, we don't want the facts to get in the way of a good story, right? But you know what? You can't afford to fall in love with a stock. When you buy shares in a publicly traded company, you're not joining that stock in holy matrimony. You don't swear to stick with it in sickness and health, for richer or poorer. You don't need to go to a judge to get a divorce. It's just a piece of paper. So acknowledge when something's changed. If you buy a stock because you believe the underlying company is going to take a ton of market share, and then it fails to do so, well, don't move the goalposts on yourself. Don't search for new reasons to hang on. Just get out of there. You must be willing to recognize that companies can take a turn for the worse. Managements make mistakes. CEOs make bad strategic and tactical errors every day. Heck, let's pick one. Let's pick Bed Bath & Beyond. You may know that one. It literally spent $5.4 billion buying its own stock back from 2013 to 2017, through 2017. And it was an ill-fated attempt to boost the earnings per share by shrinking the denominator, so to speak, and therefore take its stock price up. But it didn't really work. The company kept losing market share to online competitors like Amazon, and the buyback accomplished next to nothing. By the summer of 2018, Bed Bath had a market capitalization of less than $2.7 billion. They spent twice that amount on the buyback. If they'd simply put that money in a mattress, the company would now be worth twice as much. You know what their mistake was? The guys running Bed Bath & Beyond, they weren't flexible. They kept buying back their own stock in the mistaken belief it would help. Don't make the same error. When something goes wrong with the company you own, be ready to stop hoping and start selling. Listen, being unwilling to recognize a turn for the worse, as bad as it might be, almost always seems to lead to much larger losses than you've already accrued. The bottom line, let's bring it all together. Before you buy a stock, do some homework and come up with a thesis, a reason why you think that stock is headed higher. Once you own it, please stay flexible. If your thesis doesn't play out the way you expected it to, sell the darn stock. Don't keep bashing your head against the wall. Just recognize that things don't always go your way. And then
sell, sell, sell.
Move on. Liam in Massachusetts. Liam.
Booyah, Jim.
Booyah, Liam.
Hey, I just had a quick question about index funds.
Sure.
You say with certain stocks, buy them at certain times, like monthly or quarterly or when at a good price. Does that apply to index funds? Because you say to purchase $10,000.
Yes, but remember, what I'm really trying to do is make it so that you don't necessarily come in all at once. A lot of people just put the money to work. I actually like to space things out. Maybe try to catch when you get a real downturn. If you put all your money in before, then you can't take advantage of it. That's why I like to be flexible. Mike in Texas. Mike.
Yeah. Hi, Jim. Thanks for taking my call.
Of course.
Jim, I'd like to own some individual names in the tech space.
Okay.
But I'm finding that the prices of these stocks are just too expensive. So I've started looking at some ETFs and some mutual funds as an affordable way to gain some exposure to these names. And I'd really like to hear what your thoughts are on the matter. What do you think?
Well, one of the things that I don't like about the mutual fund industry is they don't update what they really own. So they may be buying the same stocks that you think are too pricey. When it comes to an ETF, that's just actually all you're doing is you're homogenizing the same deal. So you either have to decide that the market's too rich or that group is too rich and therefore not to buy. Or, of course, you just say, you know what? I'm going to take a long-term view and I'm not going to game it. And maybe don't buy all at once, but space out your buys. Matthew in Arizona. Matthew.
Hey, Jim. This is Matt. How's it going?
I am doing well. How about you, Matt?
I'm doing good. Couldn't be better. Hey, I got a thing for you. Is it a good idea to invest in the government? If so, should it be a short-term investment or a long-term investment?
Well, look, I mean, cash is short-term investments. Longer-term, you may just want to be able to take advantage of some higher rates and get in there and use the power of compounding. I think the conservative investor who is older should be thinking about Treasury. Some young person, and you do sound young, they don't fit. You need to take on more risk, not less. You've got your whole life to make up that money if you do lose it. Before you own a stock, come up with a thesis on why you think it's headed higher. And once you own it, please stay flexible. Much more Mad Money ahead. There's not crying in it. There's not crying in investing. I'm telling you why it's time to take emotions out of it when it comes to picking stocks. Then how the acclaimed poet Maya Angelou gave me some of the best investing advice I've ever heard. And I say there's always a bull market somewhere every night, right? And tonight, I'm telling you where to find it. So stick with Cramer.
Don't miss a second of Mad Money. Follow at Jim Cramer on Twitter. Have a question? Tweet Cramer. Hashtag Mad Tweets. Send Jim an email to madmoney@cnbc.com or give us a call at 1-800-743-CNBC. Miss something? Head to madmoney.cnbc.com.